Hello, witches, and welcome back to A Coven of Two, where we discuss witchcraft and activism. You can call me Isha, my pronouns are she, they. And today I'm gonna take you around the area where I live, which is South Wales. But before we get started, let me mention that I've opened a Ko-fi, which is basically an alternative to Patreon that takes less from creators. And on there, you can do a one-off donation or a monthly subscription donation to support the work that I do here. And you can also get tarot readings, donate what you can from £5 onwards, and you can get a tarot reading with me, Italian style. So if you would like to support what I do here, you can head on to Ko-fi. And if you do so, thank you so much. This is Cardiff. And come along with me. Come on. Come along. Yay, here. So Cardiff is peculiar in the sense that it is a seaside town, but it doesn't quite have a beach. We'll go there in a second. First thing, I'm doing some IMBOLC divination today. The flowers that I will find will tell me what is in store for me. And the first flower that I found was a dandelion. Dandelion flowers are associated with fairies and magical creatures and are said to have the power to ward off evil spirits. They can be a sign of good luck and prosperity and new beginnings, and the flower is often associated with growth, transformation and positivity. In astrology, dandelion flowers are associated with the planet Jupiter, which is also known for its expansive and benevolent energy. And probably that's why it's considered to represent growth, abundance and good fortune. Here we're going to get towards the bay, but before we get there, second flower of the day, snowdrops. The Greeks and Romans believed that the snowdrop had medicinal properties and could cure illnesses. It's usually associated with literally being the first flower that comes out in spring, and usually literally at Imbolc. It was also associated with Persephone, who was the queen of the underworld. And according to Greek mythology, the snowdrops were said to have bloomed from the tears of Persephone when she was released from the underworld, hence the Imbolc connection. In the UK, it's believed that you do not bring snowdrops flowers in the house because they are a symbol of death. That is probably because they were grown in churchyards and so related to graveyards. However, in other parts of Europe, it's considered to have the power to ward off evil spirits and protect against illnesses. This is a periwinkle, great periwinkle, vinca major. I mentioned it before, it's also called the flower of death. I discovered that it's called the flower of death because in ancient Greek mythology, the vinca flower was associated with Persephone. She was supposed to have been picking vinca flowers when she was abducted by Hades. When it comes to astrology, the vinca flower is associated with the planet Venus and the zodiac sign of Libra. It is an evergreen bush and it's a kind of myrtle, so probably that's why there's the connection with Venus as well. And they are supposed to represent a person's ability to withstand and overcome obstacles. They are considered symbols of resilience and inner strength, offering hope that can overcome adversity and emerge victorious. And in Christian tradition as well, the flower is seen as a symbol of the Virgin Mary's purity and chastity. And for Celtic folklore instead, it's associated with enchanting and magical beings. As you can tell, from the city centre of Cardiff, we have got to Cardiff Bay. Bay is very different from beach, and you will see why in a second. See, we have a barrage, but we don't quite have, because of that, something that goes directly into the sea. This mirrory thing, if you are familiar with some British TV show, that's the reason why I'm knocking on it, because Torchwood is supposed to be housed there. It's a spin-off Doctor Who. I am completely shameless in my town. So these are rocks that I got at a beach close to Cardiff in Penarth, and they used to adorn my Venus altar. But at some point, there were quite a lot of them. And so when I redid my altar a few months ago, I just decided some of them needed to be retired. So I prepared to bring them back to the sea, and this is what I'm doing now. Because we don't have a beach here in Cardiff, but sometimes being on the seaside, you do need to be in touch with the sea. Here is a day out in Abertawe, also known as Swansea. Swansea is the second, I think, biggest city in Wales, and it's less than an hour away from the train. So come along with me, we're going to discover Swansea. The weather was not amazing this day, but really in South Wales, it's throwing dice. The point is that the places are beautiful despite the weather. And the good thing about the weather is that it maintains the greenery. And here we have come to Swansea or Abertawe in Cymru, Welsh. The story about Welsh and why every sign in Wales is also in Welsh, despite the fact that a minority speaks it, it's because Welsh was a colonised country and the English imposed people from Wales not to speak Welsh. Up until the 50s and 60s, children were punished in schools if they were caught speaking Welsh. And so thankfully, since that stopped, there has been an incredible amount of work to try and preserve the Welsh language. And that's the reason why we started off, at the very least, with the signs. This was just an outdoor lounge where people could sit and therefore talk to each other. Alas, along with closing shop after closing shop. But look how amazing the architecture of this place is. It's original Art Nouveau and Deco. It has a huge kilometers long beach. And it has sand dunes and it has greenery growing on it, the odd pine or conifer there. This is the observatory. I don't know what it used to be before, maybe it was an observatory. It has a specific kind of Art Deco style to it and even to the statues outside, so it must have been there for almost 100 years. It's now just a coffee shop, but what an amazing coffee shop. Come along, we'll sit together. So the reason why we did this outing is not only to connect to the sea, but also to make memories. Something that I've realized in the last year is that much as I love my house, sometimes it's hard to make memories that stand out when your surroundings are always the same. So something that we have decided to do this year is to do more outings, more things outside. And coming here to Swansea was one of those things. It's not that different from a day that we would spend at home, except I wish we had an actual fireplace with fire at home, but we have Vesta, so almost the same, more than the same. But because it was so unique, anything that we did there was stuck in our memories much more. And Raven and I have been together 10 years in 2024, so there's a lot of memories and I want to keep having them. So every kind of silly video or picture is worth having. That's why I'm also taking so many more selfies. This is actually a round window that there was in the observatory, and that's the beach. And actually, outside on the beach, you can see it's Raven. We actually didn't plan this. I had just gone to the bathroom, and that's just her walking along the beach. The entire place was plastered with very old magazines, like original magazines. It is such a weird feeling of nostalgia. I didn't live in this country that far back. I wasn't even born that far back. But it gives you a unique atmosphere of coziness and time being stuck, which again, with thanatophobia at times helps. It also tempts you to do bibliomancy, doesn't it? Just close your eyes, point your finger, and see what letters and words stick out. This is the entrance of the observatory. If you ever are around Swansea, going out for a walk along the beach, the promenade, it's something that you will do. So it's definitely worth finding the observatory. It's just so unique. And the stuff inside is properly antique. Unfortunately, the upstairs floors were not open, so we'll have to settle for this view. Sand dunes and grass is something so unique to the UK, in my perception. There's nothing like that in Italy. I really love it. Swansea is the hometown of poet Dylan Thomas. I think it's the most famous export that they ever had. That yellow house at the back, it's incredibly beautiful, and it's actually the Dylan Thomas Centre in Swansea. Don't you go gently in that dark, dark night. That's him. Swansea has a beautiful city centre. To a degree, I think it's even more beautiful than Cardiff. This is the market of Swansea. It's huge, it's beautiful, and it has an incredible ratio of witchy shop per person. Cardiff has one witchy shop that is not even in the city centre, and then it has a crystal shop, but that's it. Swansea in the market alone has four witch shops, and there's another one called Aura just outside the market as well. I don't know why Swansea is so witchy. I love it though. This is another shop that had all the possible bronze statues of deities. You know, all the famous ones, you see them around and they're here. I love this wolfie. The wolf is Raven's animal, so that was really, really cute. There was a beautiful Bridget statue that actually reminds me why Bridget and Vesta are so syncretized. And then it was time to go back. It was just literally an afternoon trip to Swansea, but it's lovely that it's so close that we can do it. And this is an event that we had in support of medical aid to Palestine, organized by Gentle Radical in Riverside in Cardiff. I'm gonna let the footage play and I'm gonna read you something that I wrote in my journal after going there. Today I discovered that I can eat and cry at the same time. It would have been a classic joke for the lifetime I've been made fun of for my size. But what made me cry was that I looked straight in the eye of the real reason. There was a child, and she couldn't have been more than 3 years old. She didn't talk. She had dark curls and was light-skinned for an Arab girl, like I was. She was likely mixed race, like I am. She stood by a door, and I just smiled, hoping that she wasn't unawarely locking it, locking us out of the warehouse celebrating the fundraising for Gaza. My plate of fragrant falafels and freshly made hummus was my latest excuse to leave donations. My second serving. Chickpea on chickpea, what a combo. A woman needed to get out of the door, and so she opened it, towering over the child. When the door was removed, and I saw her in her unicorn socks and big inquisitive eyes, I had to say, "Hello, lovely." And it made the woman think that she was mine. No, she wasn't mine. She was me. She took the hand of the woman. There was a step, and she must have thought the woman was there to help. By that point, a woman with blue eyes came out, and indeed, she was hers. And I suddenly felt she was indeed like me. White mom, and therefore, likely Arab dad, to explain her beautiful traits. She walked past me holding her mom's hand and went past the refreshment area to the playground. Two other children were on the slide, and she was the smallest child. She came up from the side, and the child that was already there, a likely Arab boy too, made room for her, even if he was already on the slide. He looked like not only made space for her, but also made sure that she didn't hurt herself. He invited her in. Of course, now she is here and we're going to play with her too. It never happened with me. There was no other child like me, and there was no child that ever wanted to play with me. And I really never thought it was because I was Arab, because I was born in a white country of the white side of my family, raised by them. What fault did I have? What fault do any of us have? Is it our dark hair, the thick brows? Something just looks different enough and it's menacing enough, preemptively cut off. I watched the child being let on the slide and cared for automatically by the other children. And I watched so many children today being safe amongst other children. No one was put aside, and I don't even wish that had been the same for me. I'm just glad they won't be me. I want with all my might for nothing that has happened to me to happen to them. I want them to be able to stay ignorant about how much time they could have spent in a corner of the playground. Every other child moving if they got closer. And at worst, getting dog poo, ants, and glue in their black curly locks. Spending recess with the teacher because that's the only way to keep them safe, but that would make them know they are not like the other children. They are not entitled to play and grow and learn from others. I watched this girl who looked so much like I did. And much as I always took the disgust everyone had for me as reasonable, I looked at her and thought she was more beautiful than the sun. But at her age, hell, at my age, a few years ago, I had just been shown how white and pearly and blonde was lovely. I'm so glad that hello lovely was what came to me to say to her. She is lovely. I was too, but I was never told and I never understood why I knew I was lower than everyone and I had to be okay with it. A white child went to the playground as well. He climbed up the top of the slide, sat down, and then nothing. The boy and little girl were up there too, queuing now. But the blonde boy, he wouldn't budge. And suddenly, I was 3 years old myself. And in kindergarten, gangs of white children would make sure the book with the cute fairy would not be touched by me. Not because they were using it, but because they could choose for me not to have it. I don't know how much longer it has to be for those children to not be ostracized, even in a place, at a time, where it was about them and their Arab siblings being decimated in the Palestinian genocide. Just let them slide. It won't take anything away from you. You don't own the slide. You don't use the slide between the time you've come to the bottom and you go up again. So why can't they slide too?